let's start with our fourth webinar organized by the Accordion Consortium. Thanks for being here. It's my great pleasure and honor today have as a speaker Professor Marco Danelutto, my mentor. He is a food professor at the University of Pisa in the Department of Computer Science. He is very focused in the field of structured parallel programming, and both for parallel application but also for distributed architecture. And his research interests range from the design of parallel programming frameworks and adaptive management of those applications running on these systems. He actively participate to the development of FastFlow, that is a tool for highly efficient parallel programming on heterogeneous architectures. He has been participating in many research projects, both national and European. He is author of more than 200 papers, and he is definitely well focused and well positioned in the field of our interest as the project. So again, it's my great pleasure to have him here. Thank you, Marco. And the stage is yours, please.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Patrizio. So the talk today is about the title you see there and announced by Patrizio on high-level model-driven optimization methods. This will be told a little bit in general, but then we will move to the cloud edge and more specific things. And indeed, what I want to show you today is something a little bit more structured as a presentation. I want to convince you that it's a good idea to raise as much as possible the level of abstraction that we have on our while representing our parallel and distributed applications by using structure, that means particular constructs, more or less like in sequential programming. We just use a few abstractions to model any kind of behavior of our sequential programs. These two things together allow to introduce some kind of modeling of the performances or the power consumption or the efficiency of our applications. And from the usage of the structuring information, the modeling that we have, we can implement some optimizations that eventually will make our application runs faster. And this process, ideally, is something that could be applied from the smallest machine. You see a Raspberry three on the top that are just four cores, to the laptops, to supercomputers in the top 500 or cloud installations, because there are details, of course, that have to be changed, but the principles should hopefully convince you that the principles are always the same. So we speak a lot of parallel programming and of distributed programming. Parallel programming is mainly made up of three different concepts. We need to define some kind of set of concurrent activities. We need to coordinate these activities, means synchronize, communicate, share data, etc. And we need to manage lifecycle. Indeed, if we speak about distributed programming, the story is the very same. We need to define concurrent activity. We need to coordinate these activities. We need to manage the lifecycle, but the lifecycle management tools are different. The coordination happens through different ways. The times involved in the different kind of coordination are different. We use processes rather than threads or other kind of abstractions more common in the parallel world, and so on and so forth. But the idea is that we have to solve all these problems. And in any case, whether we speak of parallel or distributed computing, these activities can be different, as you see on top or on the end, but mostly make the application programming very unhappy because it has to deal with details that have nothing to do with what is actually the applicative domain, the specific knowledge he has about application, the business logic code, and so on and so forth. In the real world, let's say, we have two kind of programming models or frameworks that can be used. One is relying on explicit usage of mechanisms. The other one uses mechanisms implicitly. when we use explicitly mechanisms, we basically have application programmers that have to use variable level mechanisms. They are in charge of the burden of controlling the setup, the management, the operation of the concurrent activities, and the full set of problems related to these activities is exposed to the application programmer. So at the end of the day, what you come up with are applications that are a mix of lines of code that come from the business logic code, lines of code that come from the infrastructure that you need to set up to run it in parallel in a distributed way. And this is difficult to debug, maintain, tune, document, etc. Whereas in the implicit approach, the programmer of the domain specific programmer, the one programming the application, is exposed by means of high level programming abstractions, objects, functions, libraries, whatever, that can be used as they are. They encapsulate most of the burden that is explicitly handled on the right part of the story, and provide some kind of separation of concerns in between the application programmer that takes care of the very high level parallel or distributed implementation of the application and the business logic code, and who provides the abstractions that instead deals with all the problems that are there. And the resulting code is much better to program, so the programming, the programmability is better, tuning is easier, debugger is easier, maintainability and documentations are clearly better. Now, an example, just to couple of examples, just to deal with, to understand what we are discussing. Everybody sooner or later had to face a computation where he has to do the very same kind of computation over all the items in a collection. For instance, in a vector, here we take a vector, and for all the items in the vector, we substitute item in vector A with the function of two corresponding items in vector B and C. There is a bracket missing there anyway. So if you take an explicit programming model, for instance, on your laptop, which most likely is a multi-core machine, what you have to do is to encapsulate the business logic code, that is that particular piece of code that comes from what you have in the application, into some body that then you use as a parameter for the creation of a thread, and then you have to join the thread. So indeed, in order to split the computation among different threads, you have to prepare some chunks to be processed by the different threads. And so the user code in the auto body at the top is not exactly what we had in the code before. We have to deal with the chunks. We have to set up the chunks. We have to go through chunks and not the whole vector. So there are a small amount of details that also modify the business logic code. And then we have to deal with other details that have nothing to do with the logic of my program. Whereas if you take an implicit approach, such as the one provided, for instance, by OpenMP, which is a very common programming framework for multi-core, shared memory multi-cores, you just flag, let's say, the four with a pragma that tells that particular four is to be implemented in parallel with all the resources that you have available, and the compiler manages to take into account everything, splitting the iterations in chunks, distributed things, accessing memory, etc. But misunderstanding, there are responsibilities that have to be taken either by the programmer or the compiler that are typical of the fact that we are executing exactly that particular kind of parallel computation. So taking a collection and operating over all the items of the collection with the same computation. So we have to deal with locality. It is better if we process let's say chunks that are close, that have items close one to the other. We have to pay attention if there is fault sharing, especially when this computation is iterative. We need to take into account whether or not we can do some loop unrolling to deal with the stalls that modern pipeline processors have to insert when you go up taking a branch which is not with a certain probability. We have to be sure that we don't have loop carry dependencies in the loop. Okay, an example, the second example is from the distributed world, the distributed arena. You all know MapReduce from Google. MapReduce from Google is a very nice approach, very nice pattern where you simply say, get a collection of data, take everything in the collection and process it by means of a mapper, and then what you get has to be reduced by means of a reducer. The reducer is a binary associative commutative operator, whatever, and the mapper is a function. Anyway, if you use the framework from Google or Hadoop or any other implementation, what you have to provide in order to execute a map reduce is just the mapper function, the reducer function, the input data, and where you want to see the output data. If you write it yourself, it's a mess because you have to set up a set of map processes, typically one per PE. They have to communicate each other to synchronize where and finish the map, and then send data to some node that implements the shuffle of the keys in between the mapper and the reducer phase, and so on and so forth. Even if you take any of the available MapReduce frameworks, even those that just target shared memory multicore machines, it is easy to come up with the thousands or ten of thousands of lines of code just for implementing the process, and then the mapper and reducer could be half a page of code. So the current trend in programming frameworks indeed is to have them mostly explicit, simply because it is easier to provide mechanisms that are very efficient than providing higher level abstractions that are very efficient. So most of the available frameworks are providing mechanisms, and you have to deal with this mechanism by yourself, or they run in some kind of blended mode. It means they provide some patterns, but then you have mechanisms to escape in case those patterns do not fit perfectly or enough what you have in mind. So the workflow, the application programmer, is something where the lady here has to think to what's available as a level abstraction, so whether she can use a parallel for or not, which are the low-level mechanisms she can use, which is the business logic code she has, mix all together, make a blended mix of this kind of stuff, and come up with some source code that then she compiles using libraries, turns into an executable, and then runs the executable. If it works fine, okay, otherwise she has to go back and pick up a different higher level abstraction, or transform an higher level abstraction call into a set of low level mechanism call, or modify the business logic code, and so on and so forth. And this process could be very, very long, and especially very, very error prone. Now, just to set up the scenario, but then let's come to the central part of the talk. I want to claim that structured parallel and distributed programming models are the good thing to do to solve most of these problems. What are structured parallel programming models? We start from the idea of having parallel design patterns. What is a parallel design pattern? It's a pattern, okay, of implementation of a parallel computation, and it models something which is a common parallel computation that can be used in different applications. It's efficient, otherwise it's not worth, can be reused here and there in the same application or in different applications. It's parametric with respect to business logic code, but also to some functional parameters, such as the parallelism degree, whether or not I want to have some management of the power efficiency, and so on and so forth. And mainly, this parallel design pattern should be composable in that, ideally, we should have small patterns that model typical situations that can be used as parameters of other patterns to model more complex parallel shapes, exactly in the same way as in sequential world, you have the iterative command, finite or while or for, let's say, function call or something which is an if then else, a switch, and then you compose all those items to get very complex control flows. If you have a set of these parallel design patterns, what you can do is to implement the concept of structured parallel programming. So you have an idea in mind, it's the workflow you have on the left, and then you take this idea and you try to model parts of this idea with something which is a composition of the patterns that you have available. So the patterns encapsulate basically all those problems that normally are in charge of the application program, and you simply build something which is a legal and correct pattern composition, correct with respect to what you want to do. And this basically exposes the structure of the parallelism in such a way that we can do three things, basically, which is what I want to show now. We can model what's going on there much more precisely than if I have to reverse engineer a program using a set of mechanisms freely and in undiscriminated way. We can refactor our parallel composition in such a way that we can look for better formulation of our parallel pattern exploitation, and we can do optimizations basically. Parallel design patterns, I listed here just a list of common parallel design patterns. We keep using parallel, but I could have said distributed here. Pipeline is something which is a chain of stages. Stage I directs partial results to stage A plus I plus one and I plus one to I plus two and so on and so forth. If I'm working on a shared memory architecture on the top 500 architectures, most likely these will be threads running on some cores that direct data to other threads. If I'm running a Storm program, this will be stouts that direct tuples to other stouts, and the mechanism will be different, but the idea of having something which is a linear chain of dependencies is the base idea of the pipeline. So a lot of computations can be modeled as a pipeline. Farm represents just a functional replication of stages. Map is the application of one function over all the items of the data structure, reduces the summing up, stencil takes into account the neighborhood, and so on and so forth. So we have a number of parallel design patterns, but actually not a huge number. And we have patterns that happen to be in the category of stream parallel patterns, where the parallelism come from processing different items of the same stream, data items that appear at different times in the same place, I don't know, Twitter tweets on a Twitter stream, or stock exchange rates in a stock market, and so on and so forth. Data parallel, where instead the parallelism comes from processing collections that exist all together, one piece at a time. Or higher level patterns that try to encapsulate more complex forms. Divide and conquer is a little bit away in the middle in between. It's a data parallel pattern, basically, but it's something more than a building block for data parallel patterns, because it could be seen as a sequence of maps reduced in a sense, but indeed it is a little bit more structured. The main idea of composition is the thing that makes the whole story very interesting, because if I have pipe and functional replication, what we call farms there, then I can merge the two and say, okay, I have a pipeline where one of the stages is very slow, stage G, the second one. And so I can parallelize it by using a farm, which is there exactly to keep the throughput higher than the single sequential stage, and make things in such a way that my chain, my two chain, F, G, and H, keeps a throughput, which is not the throughput of the slowest worker in the chain, okay? And this could lead to the idea of having some kind of modeling of these activities. We are exposing the complete parallel structure, so we know exactly what we do in parallel, what are the coordination in between the different parallel agents, which is the amount of data exchanged in between. And so, for instance, we can come up with some modeling. Here I talk about performance, but we can have models concerning security. We can have models concerning power consumption of our applications. And for instance, if we speak about modeling, we can assume that the throughput, I use service time TS here, which is the inverse of throughput, telling that the service time of a sequential stage is its latency. The service time of the pipeline is the maximum of the service time. So the throughput of a pipeline is determined by the slowest stage. If I replicate things, the throughput is given by who is the bottleneck in between the guy scheduling tasks to the workers, the guy collecting results from the workers, and those workers computing things in parallel. And then I can compose these models. The last line is a composition of the model, taking into account that the pattern composition is a pipe of sec, farm, sec. And this is something that says the first thing as a TF, the last thing is a TH, because they are a sequential stage, and the middle one has the model of the farm with the proper instantiated parameters. If I have such models, I can come up with some optimizations. I don't mind knowing about how many workers I have to put into the farm. I try to figure out this as an optimal number, which is the number that matches the bandwidth of the scheduler and collector with the bandwidth of the string of workers. So if I succeed getting as many workers as the time spent in the single sequential computation divided by the time spent to deliver that computation to the worker, more or less I'm close to the optimum. Or if I have a pipeline, and for instance, here I have a pipeline with four stages taking 3 units of time, 6 units of time, 9 units of time, and another 6 units of time. Ideally, it works with a throughput of one task per 9 units of time, the slowest stage. But I can farm out the slow stage and make it come something with a double replication on the second stage, triple replication on the first stage, double replication on the last stage, in such a way that all the stage go down to 3 units of time and I get a better speed up. If you try to do the very same story, not using not exploiting the high level knowledge that this is a pipeline and pipeline of sequential stateless stage can be farmed out in each one of the stages, you are in a mess. But these transformations happen because we can do refactoring. What's refactoring? We have some rules that tell that we can take away or move or introduce or change some of the patterns. For instance, if we have to compute something as a pipeline, we can compute this very same thing as a sequential composition of two computations. If I have to do something where the first worker computes F and then the second one computes G, that's okay. I can compute F on one item while G is computed on the F, on the result of F of the previous item. But I can also do sequentially, and I can use one worker computing F, then G, and then computing the next item. And so I can do several things, and I can transform composition of patterns into other composition of patterns. They can be demonstrated that there are several rules. I show here just some of them. This was the one already discussed. One rule says that if I have to apply to all items of a collection, first a function and then another function, I can map the composition of the two functions. Or if I have to compute a map reduce one after the other, I can first compute the map with a partial reduce of the items and then do a global reduce with the partial results computed by the map in such a way that the initial part of the reduce is made in parallel and the final part is made in a tree structured way or sequentially. The map fusion rule in particular is very interesting because it says that if I have to compute the first F and then G on a matrix, for instance, I can refactor this to something computed G after having computed F, and left to right, I increase the computation gain. I take more time here. Right to left, I increase the possibility to use a different number and a different scheduling strategy for the Fs and Gs in such a way that some load balancing changing in between the two phases can be dealt with more efficiently. All in all, if I have a number of refactoring rules on a number of patterns, what I can get eventually is a space of solutions, because let's suppose that I start with the square pattern, which is here, that has a performance equal T, and then I have two refactoring rules that turn it into the diamond pattern on the cycle pattern, and then the diamond pattern could be turned by means of other rules into two other patterns, and so on and so forth. So at the end of the day, if I look for the closure of the refactoring rules, I can get a graph of things that are all derived one from the other that all compute the same thing functionally with different non-functional properties. So for instance, with different performances from the viewpoint of parallel distributed computing. And I can look for which one of these is the best one in my specific case. So for instance, if the star composition that I have here, more or less in the middle of the figure, employs much more parallel activities than the initial one, the squared one, but has the possibility to run specific activities onto specific processing nodes that have, I don't know, accelerators for that particular computation that fit that particular computation and so on and so forth, it could be the case that this achieves a much better performance than the other one. Or vice versa, it could be the case that having too much activities, it spends too much overhead to set up the computation and it doesn't work better than the coarser one. Ideally, we can set up some space exploration tools that using refactoring rules and optimization rules can interact with the user in such a way that he expresses what he wants to do, apply the rules, and eventually show which is the exploration space. Here is an example with a tool we built here in Pisa. The name is RPL Shell. You see that the user, at the prompt of this RPL Shell, defines three stages with a latency of 1, 5, and 3 units of time each, which are sequential stages. Then tells the system that we want to run a pipeline of this stage, and then ask the system to rewrite with this main with all the available rules and to optimize the main with the rule computing the optimal number of workers. There is some other sentence here missing in the plot in the dump, just indicating how much time was the time needed for spending, for scheduling and collecting items, of course. And then you can ask show main, and you see here there are 15 different alternatives that all compute the same result. We have the sequential composition, which is alternative 4. We have the original one, some one, which is 8, pipe. It is binary for convenience, but it's the original pipe. And then we have other ones, like combination 1 that says that I farmed out all the stages, or combination 2 that I only farmed out the first and second and not the third one, and so on and so forth. Ideally, if I have some possibility to parse the business logic code and to associate some business logic code to S1, S2, S3, having some predefined patterns to compile the pipeline, what's going up here, I can also ask the RPL shell to generate some parallel code. In that case, the RPL shell, for instance, I decide that the 10 is the better one, and I can generate the code for option 10. Take into account that if I was writing here show main by, I don't know, latency or service time or resources, I could have had associated to each one of the lines the number associated by that model to the form. So I can easily pick up the best one and ask to generate the code. This happens in a lot of frameworks. Some come from the industrial world. I mentioned here Intel TBB and OpenMP. Semi-structured because they provide, for instance, Intel TBB typically provides parallel 4 and pipeline with the possibility to replicate stage, so pipeline farms basically, or the possibility to implement DAGs with tasks. OpenMP only supports natively the parallel 4, but also provides the possibility to define tasks and so implement DAGs. Other environments, typically from the research arena, from academia, Skepu from the University of Linköping, Fastflow from Pisa, Muesli from Munster, and GRPPI from Madrid, actually, implement different kind of patterns. Skepu is mostly data parallel and mostly targets GPUs. Muesli and Fastflow both target stream and data parallel patterns. Fastflow is mainly targeting shared memory multicores, even if we have a version targeting MPI clusters. Muesli, since quite a time, targets also clusters and GPUs. And GRPPI is very interesting because it's a wrapper of our framework. So it has backends with generating code for C++ threads, Intel TBB, OpenMP, and Fastflow, but provides stream and data parallel patterns in a very, very C++ 17 fashion, let's say. Anyway, there are more things that we can do. In particular, we can think to do some kind of autonomic or automatic management of those features that are difficult to handle by the user. In particular, if something opened here, okay. In particular, come on. We can associate to our parallel patterns two different kinds of small mechanisms: sensors that are, let's say, probes that tell you how the pattern is performing, and actuators that slightly modify the structure of the pattern in such a way that an independent thread or an independent process or an independent manager have some policies and executes a control loop, monitor, analyze, plan, execute, a mapper loop, such that in this mapper loop, basically we look at what's going on during the phase of my
Marco, we are having some troubles in listening to you. Let's see if things are getting any better. Marco? One second, please. Let's see if Marco can reconnect. Okay, he is aware of the issue, so he's trying to manage. Hopefully we'll be able to resume this webinar soon. In the meantime, please let me remind you if you have some questions, you can either raise your hand at the end of the webinar, or you can write the messages and the question through the question and answer tool of this Zoom application. So whatever you prefer to take into account the possibility of asking questions, as I can assume that there will be many questions that arise from this very interesting presentation. So let's see. Definitely, I at least have a couple of questions. I think that we will be able soon to resume this call. Let me also check. With other means. I think that there are at least a couple, as I said, of aspects that is worth to discuss with our today's speaker that relates with our project. In fact, I think that both when talking about the fusion of operators, that is something that maybe definitely considered in our application from the viewpoint of microservices, there probably in some cases we may consider this possibility of merging them in order to have a better performances. And also one other aspect that I'd like to ask Marco his opinion on this is about the impact of how to translate several works they did in the area of quality of service improvement for the applications in the to bring that work into our okay. Marco is connected again. Marco,
ci sono. Mi sentite okay. Ancora?
Yes, you are live.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Apologize for that, but the wired network is dead, and so I had to switch to. I'm really sorry for this, but I don't know what's going on. Let me see if I can restart. I will try to be a little bit faster. I share the screen.
Okay, thanks.
Can you see it?
Not yet. Now, yes, we can.
Okay, so slideshow from current slide. I apologize for this. I don't know why, but.
Okay, don't worry. Don't worry.
That left me. So we were saying we are trying to use this idea of making something more structured for the autonomy management. So we have this process monitoring what the sensors tell is the status of the computation. We can then knowing which is the one our parallel structure, we know what we can do in order to change things that do not so well. And then we can plan some decision and execute the decision through the actuators. So we can have management rules, as an example, that look for bottlenecks in the pipeline stage and transform the pipeline stage, which happens to be the bottleneck, into a parallel replica. We can have something that looks at the performance of the farm, and if the service time is smaller than inter-arrival time, then we can increase the parallel degree. Or we can have even meta rules that, for instance, those use it to avoid fluctuation in the parallel degree or other things. Here I have a picture. I don't want to enter in the detail, but if we take the pipeline of sequential farm and sequential stage that we had before, this is an application that ran several years ago, actually, in a distributed environment. At the time, it was not a cloud, it was a grid. It was the buzzword was grid in the time. It was running on top of a proactive Java-based programming environment. And the key point is that in the second last row, you see there is a gray row, which is the bandwidth required to the system that was processing medical images. And the top rows, one and two, are those rows that basically try to figure out what's going on and try to increase the parallel degree, which is the last row, in such a way that eventually the black line enters the gray zone. That means we succeed keeping the performance to the desired levels. It was something very huge, processing a large data set of images, taking minutes. You see here the times is in minutes, seconds. So, but it was completely managed in an automatic way, just having told that if you want to keep something to the appropriate level, you can increase the parallel degree of a farm, you can farm out the pipeline stage, and so on and so forth. Here is something that makes similar things also for power management in more modern environments. But the key things, and this last point that we can do, is that we can also manage, knowing the parallel structure, heterogeneous resources, in that basically we can target different general purpose processing elements. We can target accelerators or nodes with different accessibility, different communication times, because we know that some patterns are suitable for directing, for instance, to GPUs. If I have the Jetson on the top, I can easily transfer there those computations that are MapReduce or Stencil computation. Or if I have an FPGA, I can transfer here the pipeline computations. In both cases, I can apply, for instance, in the GPU, I can do map fusion in such a way that I can get a better usage of the GPU cores. In the FPGAs, I can play with the pipeline transformation rules in such a way that I can balance the stage of the pipelines, make it shorter, in such a way that eventually I can shorten the clock cycle, which is one of the most important things I can do to explicitly and efficiently use the FPGAs. But I can also install different replicas of something which has been compiled as a pipeline to get a more bandwidth in the processing of the FPGA. So the idea again is that patterns provide you some modeling that provides you ways to efficiently target accelerators. All these can be obviously encapsulated into DSLs, the main specific languages, and where the patterns are used and provided in such a way that you achieve, you provide patterns for the very specific domain. They are still patterned, but they are domain specific. And so you have everything you need for that particular domain, not necessarily useful to be used in another domain, which is, let's say, slightly different. An example, if you take TensorFlow, TensorFlow provides you some patterns to tell where you take the data from, which kind of neural network you want to use, how you want to train it, which are the parameters that you have to use. So very efficiently in these particular things, mostly likely those patterns are not suitable for doing, I don't know, numerical processing of equations or something like that. But it notwithstanding, it hides all the details and eventually targets CPUs, multicores, GPUs. He has the possibility also to do something on FPGA, on tensor processors, and so on and so forth, that ideally would be much more complicated to use on yourself. We come more or less to the end of the story. What happens in a more distributed scenario? I show you just three samples of how we can transfer those concepts to something which ideally should be more close to the ideas of accordion and the things you're working on. Google MapReduce, you every know Google MapReduce. In Google published in the early 2000s, a paper about a concept that was called Flume, where they use exactly these kind of things to do some optimization of MapReduce computation. And things work like this. They decompose the MapReduce into component operations, parallel do, which is the map, group by k, which is the shuffle, combined values, which is the reduce, flatten, which is merging of data sets, and so on and so forth. And then they set up optimizer, parallel do fusion, a kind of map fusion, apply it to the map they need for the map phase, the deferred evaluation, that is basically lazy evaluation of high order forms, in such a way that you compute things only when the final result is needed. They build these with these building blocks, which are the parallel do, group by k, etc. They build a more complex block called map shuffle combined reduce, which is more or less a map reduce, which provides a generalized map reduce approach on top of the building blocks. And then they show that we can fuse different map shuffle combined reduce blocks, provided that they work on partially overlapping data. But the more important thing is that they define an optimization strategy, which is described in the paper in five consecutive steps, that happen to take something which is an initial naive combination of map reduce and coming up with something which is a much more efficient combination of building blocks that compute the very same result of the first one more efficiently. And these steps happen to be a first step where we flatten, we move flattens to the sink. So we try to do the flatten of the data close to the maps. The second step combines, lifts the combined values, so groups combined various in group by k, make a merge of shuffle and reduce, let's say, in a more naive way. Then they set fusion blocks, so we do some merging again in between the parallel do and the group by k. Finally, if they have maps followed by maps, they fuse them. And finally, they fuse also the map, shuffle, combine, and reduce operations in such a way that they obtain something
very structured and very and much more efficient than before. All this is possible just because they clearly identify which are the components, the building blocks, and clearly identify the semantics of composing these building blocks exactly as we did for the patterns. If you take Storm, which is one of the environments that you use for stream processing, even there you can do much more interesting things. For instance, take into account a graph where we have, such as the one that I took from the documentation, the typical example, we have a couple of bolts that source some data on the left part of the picture, and then some spouts that just process filter this data. If you have some spouts processing F1 and then F2, one after the other, no, it's not the case here in the example, or it is the case in the upper chain, the second last and the last spout actually happen to be one after the other. We can also think to rewrite them on the same spout in such a way that we have a coarser grain, and sooner or later we mask better the overhead which incurs in the communication of tuples in between this spout and the bolt, for instance. Or if we figure out that a particular spout is not performing as expected, we can do some replicas if it's stateless, or if it is stateful, we can figure out how to optimize some kind of server encapsulating the state in such a way that multiple replicas can interact with the server and do some improvement in the throughput of that particular spout, even if there is a state inside. Again, these are all things that you can do if and only if you know how things work and exactly which is the semantics of what you are doing in terms of parallel distributed computations. Last but not least, a typical scenario when you use cloud, edge, and devices is using cloud and edge as offloading devices, let's say for your own mobile phone, laptop, or whatever, no? This is usually statically programmed in F. So you buy an app, and the app has some part that knows that somewhere in the cloud there is a service that you can invoke to do that part of computation that cannot be afforded on the mobile phone because of the number of, I don't know, cores or the power or the battery life or whatever. No. If we take a model-driven perspective, indeed, we can look at the high-level parallel structure of the application, look at which are the data sources and things defined, and try to use Edge and Cloud as accelerated dedicated device using the same approach we have in skeletons for using the GPUs or FPGAs accelerators, because at the end of the day, we can see an edge as a large pre-processing thing that can pre-process or process small amounts of data before delivering the rest of the processing to the cloud, which is the one with larger processing power. But we can also have some kind of more, let's say, intelligent approach to this. Take as an example the left part of the feature there. That's a, for we old guys, this is flowchart. You can take it as a workflow in a more modern terminology, no? We have an application that to the purpose has not been depicted as a composition of patterns, but just as a composition of phases, A, B, C, D, E, with conditionals in between A that can choose whether to keep up going with B or C, disks read somewhere, input read somewhere, et cetera, et cetera. No? Now, if B and D, which are bold there, are the easiest phases, those that not supported or not, cannot be supported on our mobile phone, we decide that we can decide to offload that particular computation to the cloud, and that's it. But if we are looking at the structure a little bit more carefully, we can apply some of the factoring rules that we had before. For instance, D has to be executed both after B and C. So we can also imagine to merge B and D and C and D and take them as alternatives rather than B and C alternatives and then D common path in such a way that we have something which is coarser grain. Imagine a larger stout to be computed in Storm. And this could be more easily dispatched on the cloud or more easily set up because I don't need the coordination between B and D and C and D that anyway have to be executed one after the other. And so at the end of the day, I can have something like in the right part here, where BND and CND have been merged into unique blocks, let's say. They stay close to the disks they need to access in order to compute. E and A take A as the pre-processing of the user input, and E the post-processing needed before showing the output to the user, can be taken on the edge closer to the device because mostly likely they are lighter computations. And eventually on the device, I can keep just the I/O or a minimal management of the user interface and get the input and send the input to the proper place, etc. Again, this can be done just because we know the parallel structure. So this is the last slide. I hope to be in time despite the interruption. We have a wish list on the left, and we have something that we need to implement the wish list on the left. So it is fundamental to expose the level structure of our parallel distributed application. If we don't use this knowledge, we most likely will be able to do very good things, but very specific things that cannot be reused in other case, cannot benefit from the existing results, et cetera, et cetera. We need to separate the concerns, definitely. So if I use the high-level structure, if I implement the high-level structure of my application using something which is provided by experts, so providing these kind of bricks, that's a good idea. And avoids the application programmer to know too much about the architecture or whatever. And we need to exploit autonomic management of all those features that are cumbersome to deal with, do not require particular intelligence, let's say, do not require human intervention, and are much more fastly executed and taken into account by autonomic managers than by the programmers. In order to do that, we need models, we need refactoring rules, and last but not least, take into account that all these posts holds and it's true, not only for data parallel computations. At the very beginning of the story, if you go back in the 50s, one century ago, last century, people was getting crazy to make, system of linear inequation faster and faster executed on computers. And they were looking only at the data parallels. You have the vector of, we had matrix multiplication, you have to do the multiplication of the row by column in the fastest way possible, vector units, ALUs, FPUs, and everything. No? Today, you need to process the stream of tweets or the data stock quotes or simply the temperatures from sensors. And these are mostly streaming data, and these have the same dignity of data parallelism, and all can benefit from the framework I tried to convince you is a good idea to adopt in this seminar. That's all. So if you have questions, I will be happy to answer. And I apologize again for the interruption that I come to the department to the purpose to make the webinar, and I was not expecting to have a failure on the network, of course.
Thank you very much, Marco. Thank you for this very interesting presentation. I remind you that if you want to ask questions, you need to raise your hand and then I can open your mic. Okay, the first question is from Massimo Coppola. Massimo, go ahead.
Yeah, hi Marco. I was wondering if there is some research work addressing the relationship and the differences between the refactoring rules that you can apply statically and those that you can apply dynamically, because in principle this is exactly the same set of transformation. However, in some cases, restructuring considerable part of the program at runtime may bring an unnecessary overhead. So basically, if you want to remove a farm and you are working at runtime, you probably set the farm with the parallelism one. You don't really remove all the support code or support processes for the farm. So my understanding, the two set of refactoring rules can be slightly different. Some optimization are best done or at static time, at compile time. Others are best done at runtime. Others are only possible at runtime because you don't know the behavior of the code in advance. And I was wondering if there is some research trying to understand a common set of transformation or the difference between the two sets.
Thank you for the question, Massimo. The problem is real, and you pointed out correctly that there are things that it's easy to do at runtime and things that are easier to do at compile time. So, in principle, the rules do not embed any kind of necessity, knowledge, barra constraints, or constraints relative to the fact whether they have to be executed at runtime or at compile time. They are rules because they host as they are and they state functional equivalence. So it doesn't mind whether you state this equivalence at runtime or at compile time. At compile time, of course, you are setting up the scenario so you can do whatever you want. Could take longer or shorter. It doesn't mind. If you came up with a better solution, then that's a better solution and you can spend any time. We are speaking of compiling parallel distributed applications. You know very well that if you are using, for instance, accelerators such as the GPUs, the FPGAs, you are easily required to spend hours to await for the compilation of the bitstream that need to configure the FPGA. So I don't mind at compile time how much time I spend. At runtime is mostly a matter of convenience, and the usage of managers there also implies that in the modeling that you have, it is required to have models also for the overhead that you introduce applying a rule. So if the rule is taking away a worker from a farm, most likely is taking away or adding, is the same, is intervening on a data structure and adding or taking away a process ID or a thread ID or a channel ID from the list. So you can do in background the setup of the activity, and then you can do the operation very easily. If you have to change the structure of the computation, so for instance, if you have to transform something which is a composition of patterns into a completely different composition of patterns, this most likely is made by compiling both possibilities and then activating the one that you need at the time. But there is no real research on the differentiation because the rules happen to be valid in any of the two cases.
Okay, thank you very much, Marco.
Okay, other questions from the attendees? In the meantime, that people decide whether to ask questions or not, I have a couple of, actually, at least one that is, I think, strongly related with your presentation and our activity in the project. That is, you mentioned the fact that you actually perform these transformations in order to achieve a given quality of service. Others mentioned this as a service level agreement that need to be fulfilled. In the context, the specific context of our project, our main interest is on the quality of experience. That is a slightly different perspective, because instead of defining this for an application in isolation, is the performance that application performs and provides to an end user. So where the ability of reacting in order to satisfy the expectation of the user in terms of latency are very important. So what I was wondering if when you mentioned the transformation that you can perform for achieving a given quality of service can need to be rethought in order to manage the quality of experience aspect instead of a quality of service aspect.
You mean the way we propose these changes to the user or what?
No, as in according, for instance, most of the transformation of loading and the redistribution of the application are made in order to bring the computation closer to the user with the objective of providing a solution, a completion time of a task that is less than a given threshold. So the key aspect is the latency between the end user and the application. So I was wondering if you envision some of the transformation that you mentioned to be adopted in this specific field or not.
But for sure, let's say all those transformations that allow to exploit in a better way what we call accelerators, but they are not actual accelerators, let's say more suitable devices to execute some particular task is welcome, no? And the idea here is exactly to be able to identify which are the tasks that can be the part, let's say, of the workflow that can be more suitable to be executed in certain parts of the available, in certain categories of the available resources, no? Because usually what you do, I mean, there are something that you can do in a gross way, in a very coarse grain. If I am speaking about using some kind of artificial intelligence or neural network stuff, it is clear that I can do the training somewhere and the computation of the classification on some other place, no? But if you go finer grain and you try to figure out what in the part that you use on the device to use the coefficients computed during the training is itself a composition of parallel patterns, then it may easily turn out that those parts are more suitable, for instance, to be accelerated using the phone GPU or the particular device that can be present on the device or on the laptop that you're using or whatever, or on the edge closer to the device that you are using in that particular moment. So yes, the answer is yes. I mean, structuring and being able to identify at the finer grain in the application which are the parts connotated, marked as parallel, but not parallel generically, parallel with that particular pattern, can be used and exploited to make the implementation more efficient and so contribute to get them a smaller latency as perceived by the user.
Okay, thanks, Marco.
It depends on the classification and it depends whether A, you are able to find different parts that are not the very coarse grain ones, and B, if you have enough resources or resources matching those parts that you are identifying in point A. Hmm.
Okay, thanks for this. We have another question from Sotirios Exidis. Yes. If you want Sotirios to ask it live, please go ahead instead of just writing it.
Yes, sure. Thank you. Thank you, Patricio. Thank you, Professor, for the very interesting talk. My question is, if there are some related research or some mechanisms that have been already employed regarding pattern selection under the scenario that there are heterogeneous resources. So consider a scenario that you want to perform the farming transformation, right? But you have a part to be executed on an embedded device, another part on an embedded GPU, or the other one on FPGA. Are there any mechanisms that or models that enables the, let's say, the non-homogeneous partition of workload according to the type of the underlying device?
Yes. Yes, we can do several things. Actually, in past projects from different sources, let's say, there have been different techniques that can be used for this. For instance, somebody from the University of Darmstadt some 4 or 5 years ago managed to install on an FPGA a kind of server being able to execute with different replicas numbers a given number of functions. So ideally, if you have function f, g, and h to execute on some data, they were able to install an executor that takes a generic task, which is written, I have to do f or g or h, from the PCI Express interface. So more or less offloading something with a call from the host. And this was used to show, let's say, more or less in the same way you can do with the GPUs, to evaluate whether, given a collection of tasks, every data parallel collection or a stream collection, it was convenient to move the data to the heterogeneous architecture, to the heterogeneous coprocessor, let's say, or not. The idea that came up with is that depending on the amount of time that you spent in the computation and the amount of time that you spent in offloading the computation to the embedded device or to the accelerator, you can come up with percentages of tasks to direct in one place and in the other place in such a way that eventually you can anyway reduce the latency of the total number of tasks that you have to compute. And this was quite interesting, especially because, for instance, a similar work has been made for GPUs, and here people figured out that there are several different classes of computations that, when executed on a GPU only, of course, altogether on the CPU only would have taken more time, but certain classes would have taken a large amount of a much larger amount of time, and some computations would have taken a larger but comparable amount of time, in such a way that in the second class you can probably split, I don't know, 70% of the tasks to the GPU and keep the rest on the CPU and still get some improvement versus executing the total number of tasks on the GPU. So there are several things that you can do that again are enabled just by the fact that you know that the tasks are independent or they are parts of a map of a stencil or whatever, so you can move the data necessary or the data is already there. So there are different things that you can do in that field.
Thank you.
I don't know if this answers your question completely or...
The question was more on the modeling, if there are some models that enables
yes, that. But all this is in fact, all this is enabled by the modeling, no? Because in the modeling, you have to take into account not only the time you spend to compute, but also the time you spend to set up the computation. So all the time needed to transfer the kernels to the accelerators, the time needed to transfer the data. That was why I was telling you about this. In one of the environments that I mentioned, in SCEP, which is targeting mainly the GPUs, here they installed a concept of container that through modeling is exactly something that enables the system to figure out whether data transferred to the GPU has to be kept or not on the GPU for further computations or for optimizing some data transfers that could be issued later on for solving other problems. Or people from the university in Paris, the group of Paris 6, for instance, some years ago, they came up with a thing that was an OCaml runtime, basically, that using the garbage collector of OCaml and representing data transferred to the GPUs as OCaml objects, were able to figure out whether or not data was on the GPU already, on the CPU to be transferred from CPU to GPU or vice versa, depending on the computations. So there are many, many things that are exactly modeling that then install computations to be executed here and there. Without modeling, you do nothing. And the models here are more complicated because in some sense, you have to take into account all a set of parameters that normally you forget about when not using heterogeneous architectures, and especially using architectures where the cost of accessing memory, even if it's NUMA, it's not that NUMA as it is with the with heterogeneous architectures, basically, where you have to move through a bus before coming to the right place.
Exactly, exactly. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you again. Let me check if there are any other questions. If there is any question, no, apparently. I don't see any question. Okay, so I think we can close the event now. Thank you again, Marco. If by the way you have the mail of Marco here, but in case you forgot it, don't hesitate to contact me. I can forward your request to him or put you in contact with Marco if needed. So thank you for this webinar, Marco. It has been enlightening. So thank you everybody for attending the meeting. I think we can close here the event.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the patience waiting me for reconnect. Bye bye.
Bye bye.